I would like to thank to great engineer, and now I would like to invite Professor Husák to make the speech.
Já využiju téhle prodlevy jenom abych upozornil všichni ve svých materiálech, které
So I would like to see that everybody you can find it in your folder you found on the chair. So if you'd like to attend Fata Morgana greenhouse, so you have a map there where to go. So I just wanted to draw your attention to this map.
Dobrý.
Ladies and gentlemen, I was asked to make a short presentation, so bad news is that my presentation consists of 55 slides, but I'll try to be brief. The topic is where electronics is being developed. So in this picture, you can see that electronics has a certain development. Many elements are integrated now, but generally we can say that it started with the invention of transistor. Transistor has changed the possibilities and also the approaches. So our today's semiconductor electronics is following objectives. It means diminishing size, increasing performance, and also limit frequencies. So this leads to the structures being shrinking. So it depends on the size of the gate. And you can see that we have completely new structures. We have vertical transistors and nanotechnologies, processes and everything. We could continue. We have new materials, for example, molybdenum. So we have a transistor there. So the consumer is a consumption of energy is 10 to 5 in standby regime is slower. So we could use 3 to 4 nanometers. It is already in the quantum area. So this is the development of semi. Conductors, the direction goes towards diamond, and I visited Onisemi in Rožnov, and they started to based on silicon, and they do also gallium nitrogen materials. So this all leads that when we are talking about nanoelectronics, so we're using knowledge from nanotechnology and new structures and approaches are being developed. So we have a quantum engineering as a new notion. It means that transistors are being designed atom by atom. And new materials are being used there. So 2D heterostructures, typically graphene. And due to this, we have new structures of elements of future. Vertical, lateral ones, graphene, this is the gray layer. This graphene is enabling creating gates which are much more efficient in the elements. So this is a roadmap. We have vertical and horizontal structures there. Intel is using it for processes, and this is just an example where it is leading to. This roadmap leads to 2030. Carbon-based materials are used. Fullerene was invented, and 1996 Nobel Prize was awarded for it. And now nanotubes, we are looking for new structures, how to copy transistors and how to produce out of it new elements from it or new parts from it. And well, it's not very good and usable because tube falls down and then you have a connection there, you have a gate there. Graphene was invented in 1960, but his properties were investigated at the Manchester of University by these two scientists who were awarded a Nobel Prize. So the properties are very important in the magnetic field, electronic, and so high conductivity. Graphene is one or two atomary, so it means we can change P and E using the voltage and create different types of semiconductors, which means that we can produce the different types of amplifiers, integrated circuits, even in a digital form. This is a mixer based on graphene. But this graphene is a material future, is being tested in many ways. It's capacitory, so it's can be used in batteries, memory cells, displays. So it means flexible displays is one of the applications. So this is a short clip as an example. So as for the flexible displays, so there are certain examples already. And if you just have the display of graphene falling down on the stone, nothing happens. The electronics has a certain limit. It means that of semiconductors. So new ways are being looked for example, optical, fiber optics. And one which is being now is transportation of energy by fiber optics, for example, in medicine. So, for example, it's being feeded, the source being feeded, and it's transferred into optical signals by laser. Then you can conduct it and transfer it, and in the end you have a converter, and you can convert it back to the electricity. So Fraunhofer has very advanced technologies. We start to pay attention to it, and the principle is that you have fiber optics, and in the second picture you can see the performance, which can be transformed into light. Then we have a data, and when it is put together, so down there in the picture you can see that one fiber can transport or transfer data and also energy. So the advantages of these solutions is that we have six typical fields here of galvanic department, protection against light in automotive industry, decreasing the weight, and this works very well. And this is a picture, laser energy converter. And this is an arrangement of separation of high voltage from the low one. You can see the laser here, and the optic fiber transfers it over there to the receiver, and the receiver works at 10 kilovolts. The second example, so we have sensors reading information there, and the optic fibers are bringing energy into it and taking back the data. We need acceleration. We need more accurate calculations, and that's why quantum technology is being developed. Sometimes we talk about quantum computers, they haven't advanced much, but the quantum technologies are here. There are some features of that, but the quantum computers are not here to be the best. They are quite quick and quite accurate, but if there are some supercomputers, the quantum computers cannot take over their tasks. So in quantum systems are working also with spins. Bit with the standard computer, the quantum bits are called qubits, and they have different spins, and they give them much more possibilities in applications. Sometimes they are working very close to absolute zero. But there are even some chips which are working 3.7 Kelvin. They're called so hot qubits. This is a so-called high temperature. Some of these chips have been implemented already. So the maximum implement is 54 qubits. It's not much, but the development marches on. And Google set up a computer which is 1 billion times quicker than the most powerful supercomputer in the world. But it solves only some problems. So a Google quantum computer has completed a certain problem in 3 minutes 20. And the most powerful supercomputer would be working on it 10,000 years. This is a microprocessor. Which has 54 qubits displayable sycamore. And this is the maximum. The important thing is that you can link the qubits to achieve higher power. This is a quantum chip, how the interlinkage of qubits looks like. These are the qubits, but probably it's not self-explicatory too much, so it doesn't tell you much. This is a qubit. Those we were built were built on the technology 22 nanometers is the basic technology. A picture of microprocessor encapsulated, and this is a side. It's necessary to have shading there. This is a high vacuum there, because we have to shade it from the magnetic field of the Earth. To conclude with, I would like to look into the future. The moment we create super quantum computers, so it will be a problem to pay by a card. This could be a danger. This is a risk. But these systems lead to acceleration and make more accurate calculations, which is the case, for example, in decoding cryptographic codes. Thank you very much for your attention.